Well, hello, I'm Stephen Saylor. I'm director of the Mark Twain Museum in the Territorial Enterprise Building here in Virginia City, Nevada. We are currently under restoration, and where we are right now is the basement of the Territorial Enterprise. This building was built in 1975. It went through a fire and was rebuilt. Originally it was four stories and now it's three. But downstairs here is where all the original printing took place. On the main floor upstairs is where they had 25 people setting type. And then they would send it down a dumbwaiter, and then they would bring it over and lock them into the press and print the paper. And they would take them back over and send them back upstairs. And then they would take all the little type back and put it back in the type case boxes and start all over again. And it was a daily paper, so they had 25 people just setting type. And they had four, five, six people down here running the presses and printing the paper. And the desk I'm standing in front of, this was Mark Twain's desk. This desk was originally across the street where the Silver Queen is located. And they had the office for the writers there and the editor. And then they would send the copy over here, and then they would typeset the copy to print the paper. And this went on and on and on every day, day and night, 365 days a year. The Territorial Enterprise originally started in Juneau, Nevada, which was then called Marvin Station. And the original newspaper there was started by two guys in 1856. And then when Brigham Young called all the people back to Utah, they moved the paper to Carson City, which was soon to become the state capital. And it was there from 1857 to 58. And then in 1859, when they discovered silver up here in Virginia City, the town started to take off. So they moved the paper up here to Virginia City on B Street in a small little building, and which they quickly outgrew. So then they moved down into here and built this building. 1875, it opened. And then the paper ran from 1875 to 1919. And then it closed down. And then it had a rebirth again in the 20s, ran through the 30s. And then it closed again. And then in 1950, two journalists from back east, Lucius Beebe and Clegg, bought the paper and came out here to Nevada from Boston and New York, and started a new Territorial Enterprise paper, and that ran from 1950 to 1969. And then it closed down again. Our long-term goal is to start publishing a monthly paper using the presses that we have, and building up subscription and getting the Territorial Enterprise back into a national focus on it.
This press is a Ho newspaper press built in the late 1800s. And they would bring the forms with handset type down a dumbwaiter from upstairs where they had set the type. Then you take it from the dumbwaiter, bring it over, put it into the bed of the press, and then this cylinder turns. Someone would be standing up on the top with a stack of paper and feeding the paper one sheet at a time as it turns. And this power is powered by either steam, or later it was powered by water, with water pressure coming off the mountain. So this was the top technology of the day. And here it was in Virginia City in the 1800s. And this table here is has a slab of marble on top. It was the flattest surface that they could get at the time. And that's where they would set the frame of the page of a newspaper.
They fill that frame with handset type that was set one letter at a time, and that type was about 7/8 of an inch high. They would, and the formula for that type was lead mostly, a little bit of antimony, and just a touch of tin to keep it a nice smooth surface. That formula hasn't changed since Gutenberg in the 1440s. So Gutenberg sort of invented the formula, and it carried on for what now, 600 plus years. So, but they would set that type into a frame, they would lock it up with some wedges, they would carry that form to the press over here. Now they did that initially, probably right here. Later on, when the circulation became worldwide, they had probably 20 or 30 typesetters upstairs, setting the type, locking it into the form upstairs, and then sending it down the dump later on, and then taking it and putting it into the press. It's rumored, and I kind of believe this, that after they put the press to bed for the night, the reporters and the pressmen would find a nice saloon and maybe imbibe a little too much. It's rumored that they might come back here and not quite make it home, and it's rumored that Mark Twain may have slept on this slab one or two nights. We don't know for sure. We're checking for fingerprints. And this is a typical type cabinet with a type case in or drawer in each slot. And in these cases, they would keep different size type, different face or designs of type, and depending on what they were doing, making a headline or making a display for an advertisement, they pull different type and put it onto a stand. And I don't know if you can see this. This is a typical type stand. If they were setting type for the newspaper, they'd have the small letters on this lower case. That's where the term lowercase letters come from. And they'd have the capitals up here, or the uppercase letters. Each one of these cases holding a different part of the type and alphabet. And this is called a proof press. More particularly, a rolling pin proof press, because it has this rolling pin feature. And what the compositor would do is set the type and then stack that type into a column. Think of a column in a newspaper. And then they would put it in here for a quick and dirty proof to just check for spelling. The old-fashioned spell check was the editor. They put the type in here. They'd take a hand brayer or roller and put a little ink on it and ink that type, put a piece of paper on it and roll the pin over it for pressure. Then they pull it back, take that piece of paper, give it to the editor. The editor would mark it up for corrections and hand it to the compositor, who'd have to say, I gotta do that. Okay, I gotta change all of these things. And changing little tiny pieces of type is a tricky process, so you don't want to have to do it more than once if that's the level of quality for the press. But for fine books and other publications, they might go back and forth doing proofs over and over and over again until it's perfect, until the editor signs off on it for book publication. For newspapers, not so much. If there's a typo here and there, people read over it, and it's no longer of interest after the day of publication. Okay, this is considered a job press, or a Gordon clamshell press. It had various names, but this was a press used for everything but newspapers. So this would be for stock certificates or letterhead stationery, business cards, and whatnot. And the way it worked is that you had this ink plate covered with ink.
We had rollers that ran across from side to side, and this is where you fed the paper. And so as it closes, the type would be in here. As it closes, these rollers would come up to get ink for the next print, while this one is actually printing. And then as it comes back, you would pull the printed sheet out, put a blank sheet in, and get it ready for the next print. This was treadle operated. No need for electricity. And they could print about 500 to 800 copies an hour.
Wow.
So if you needed 500 business cards, you could come back in an hour or two and they might be done. It's stiff. So this is a treadle operated press. It did not require electricity. And as you can see, it just keeps on going as long as you can pedal. A little bit of extra exercise. And this is a linotype machine. This was the invention of a fellow by the name of Mergenthaler, and it took the place of handset type. In the late 1890s, about 1895, he invented this machine, which underneath this plate, there are various slots. Each slot has one character, so it might have a slot with all A's, a slot with all B's. And as you hit the keyboard, one of these little brass matrices or molds with indented letters, not type, but molds, would slide down and come in and create a line of brass molds, which would be a sentence. And then you'd open this part up, slide the brass molds over, close it up, and inject molten type metal, which is bubbling up in the back, either heated by gas or later on electricity, depending on the machine. Out of this line would come a line of type. And this is at the end of the day, they didn't have to set the type back into type cases. They just threw these back into the melting pot and recycled it. This linotype machine was the first one west of the Mississippi. Why? Because the Territorial Enterprise was the largest newspaper in the West. Larger than Sacramento, larger than San Francisco, and Los Angeles wasn't even started yet. So, interesting enough, the Territorial Enterprise was very prosperous, had lots of money, and they got the latest technology in the West.